Hello guys,
Doc,
this
there's no
is
audio.
our topic for today, and this is about
Okay.
a discussion on the measures
Doc,
of
we are able
disease
to hear it, Doc.
oral. Is the audio and video? Is the audio and also the video okay?
Yes, Doc, it's clear.
Okay. This is our topic for today, and this is about a discussion on the measures of disease occurrence. Why do you need to study the measures of disease occurrence? There are at least 7 points that can provide the relevance and importance of knowing the measures of disease occurrence. Here are four of these 7 points. Point one has something to do with providing the scientific aspect in every disease and injury prevention and in the promotion of health. The second point is important in setting the priorities for research and action. Now, point three, by identifying the needed measures of disease occurrence, the section of the population in a given geographical region that has the greatest risk can also be identified for the much needed interventions. If the population with the greatest risk is identified in a given region, then the evaluation of program effectiveness to improve the health of the population can be more relevant and meaningful. Okay, now the next 3 points follow. Point five, which is about knowing and evaluating the history of disease from initial states through clinical course, is important to be able to carry out points 6 and 7, which are actually conducting the surveillance of disease and injury in certain populations and investigating the outbreaks respectively. Let us now look at the two kinds of approaches in epidemiology when analyzing surveillance data or when you do an outbreak investigation. One is descriptive epidemiology in order to measure disease occurrence. Another is analytical epidemiology to identify disease determinants. In our topic, we will only cover the descriptive approach because in here we are interested in measuring disease occurrence. Measuring disease occurrence can aid in quantifying potentially causal relations between exposure and disease. Hence, based on derived information, an effective response or intervention can be organized. If there is presence of health issues and diseases in the community, the descriptive approach typically involves asking the four W's. The what question typically focuses on identifying the health problems of the community and the characteristics of the illnesses found. The who question seeks to identify how many persons are affected and the characteristics of these persons. The when question tries to get the period of time pertinent to the occurrence of the illnesses being investigated. And the where question, on the other hand, identifies the location of the persons affected by illnesses that are present in the community. It is important that each of the W should be well defined to obtain comparable measures across several geographical locations. Related to outbreak investigation is the count. It is a simple and therefore most frequently performed measure in epidemiology. It refers to the number of cases of a disease or other health phenomenon. It also provides an absolute number of the burden of disease. It has limited usefulness for epidemiologic purposes because the measure does not provide information about the size of the source population and the time dimension. The burden of disease in the population is very different if the population size is 100,000 versus 1 million. Some people are not at risk for developing a new onset of an outbreak due to pre-existing condition, probably. Thus, we need to know not only the size of the total population, but also the size of the total population at risk. Later in our discussion, we will cover risk and what it has to do with epidemiology. In the subsequent slides, I will cover several measures of disease frequency, such as risk, cumulative incidence, attack rates, and prevalence. But first, we will try to understand how a ratio, proportion, and a rate are defined in terms of what and who is contained in the denominator, and in terms of what time period the disease occurred. Okay, now regarding disease occurrence, think about the numerator and the denominator. Let's start with the ratio. It is basically a quotient of two numbers because the numerator is not included in the denominator. It allows comparison of different quantities. An illustration here shows that the ratio of females to males is 2.5 to 1, or 5 females for every 2 males. More examples of ratio are shown here. They are number of beds per doctor, that is 85 beds for one doctor. And then we have number of participants per facilitator, that is 3 participants for 1 facilitator. And then we have number of inhabitants per region, that is 10 individuals for 1 region of a certain country X. And then we have the male to female ratio, that is 5 males for 1 female in country Y. And then we have the female to male ratio, that is 2 females for 1 male in country Z. A proportion, on the other hand, is also a quotient of 2 numbers, but it is a special ratio. The numerator is always included in the denominator. Now, as you can observe, the 3 female individuals in the numerator are also in the denominator together with the 2 male individuals. Also observe that the quantities have to be of the same nature. The proportion always ranges in value from 0 to 1, and the percentage is calculated from the proportion multiplied by 100. For example, 3 out of 5 individuals are female in this particular illustration. So the proportion of females in this group is 60%. Another example of a proportion is the number of intravenous drug users among 141 cases of tetanus during an outbreak of tetanus in country X. The proportion of IDUs among the group of tetanus cases is 2 out of 141. And this corresponds to 0.014. And if expressed in percentage, it is 1.4%. Okay, now rate is also a quotient of two numbers and a special kind of ratio. However, it measures the speed of occurrence of an event over time. It includes the time and the population where events are observed. The illustration shows that two female individuals acquired a rare disease in the year 2008 out of a population of 52 individuals. The rate, therefore, is 0.038 per year. Another example of rate is the mortality rate of tetanus in certain regions of country Z. In this example, there are 17 tetanus deaths in the year 1995 out of a population of 58 million. The mortality rate, therefore, is 0.29 per 1 million per year. Now, rate may be expressed in any power of 10, like 100, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, 1 million. In epidemiology, the study of occurrence of illnesses is of prime importance. There are other types of measures that give more information relevant to the importance of epidemiology. These are incidence rate, cumulative incidence, attack rate, and prevalence. But we need to look at the risk first. So what does risk have to do with epidemiology? Before we discuss more measures, let's have an overview of what risk is. Commonly used, the term risk can mean many things and is usually used for negative events that are quite unclear. As epidemiology is a precise science, there is a clear definition of risk. The nature of risk is probabilistic, and the usual question raised about risk is, what is the probability that an event will occur? Risk is estimated by observing events in a population during a specified time. Let us now look at cumulative incidence. Cumulative incidence is also often called the incidence proportion. It is a very important measurement in studies involving risk as a subject. In our numerator, we will have the number of new cases of a disease during a specified period. And in the denominator, the population at the beginning of the observation period. In this example of occurrence of echinococcosis in country X during the year 2014, a total of 1,250 new cases were observed in a population of 350,000 individuals, which results in a cumulative incidence of 0.0036 per year. Now, this can also be expressed as 0.36% of the population that newly acquired the disease during 2014. This number may be difficult to understand because it is a small number. However, this number may be expressed more clearly as 3.6 new cases per 1,000 persons during the year 2014. Okay, this is about the risk of acquiring a disease in a given population in a given period of time, which is 12 months or 1 year. Now let's make a graphical example. Let's assume that in a population of 12 individuals, 7 get a certain disease. As you can see here, any person living in this population will have a risk of 58%. The cumulative incidence or incidence proportion is the percentage of population that get a disease in 1 year. In our case, 7 out of 12 individuals, which is 58%. Now, this means that 58% will get the disease during the year of observation. Now, here, X represents the onset of the disease. So, as you can see here, we have 7 individuals getting the disease out of 12. It is important to observe here that the cumulative incidence or incidence proportion assumes that the entire population at risk is followed up for the same period of time. Now let's deal with the attack rate. Attack rate is the cumulative incidence during an outbreak. It is expressed for the entire epidemic period from the beginning up to the end of the epidemic. It is important to know that it is rather a proportion than a rate. What is special about a proportion? Persons in the numerator are always included in the denominator. It indicates the magnitude of a part related to the total. In epidemiology, it tells us the fraction of the population that is affected, that is A divided by the denominator, which is composed of A plus B. And the numerical value of A proportion ranges from 0 to 1. If multiplied by 100, you get the percentage value. Attack rate is a cumulative incidence within an outbreak. It is used widely everywhere. Here is an example of attack rate. During an outbreak of cholera in country X in 2016, among a population of 18,600 individuals, 490 persons got the disease. This therefore resulted to an attack rate of 2.6%. After the attack rate, let us have the incidence rate. It is a precise measure because it includes the time at risk in the denominator. The incidence rate is equal to the number of new cases divided by the total number of person time observed. It is important to know that when using the term rate, a measurement of time is included in the denominator, and that the persons included in the denominator are those that enter an area, say a study area, until they either develop the disease or they are not at risk for developing the disease anymore. That is, they moved out, they got immune, they are lost, and so on and so forth. So, the denominator is the sum of each individual's time while at risk and when free from the disease. In the next slide, we will have a graph that show the meaning of this. So, let us assume a population of 5 persons. Person A is followed from 1990 until the end of 96 because he may die or be lost to follow-up. He or she will contribute 6 years to our observation. Now, person B is born in 1992 and develops a disease in 1998. He or she will contribute 6 years to our observation. Person C contributes to the entire observation a period of 10 years. Now, person D moves to the entire study area in 1991 and leaves the area in mid-1999. He or she will contribute for 8.5 years. Now, person E develops the same disease after 5 years. So, our denominator will be the sum of the time of each individual at risk when they are free of disease, which in our example is equal to 35.5 person years. In this graphical example, persons B and E develop the disease. Therefore, as a summary, there are two new cases of a disease for a total of 35.5 person years as time of observation. The total person time observed will become our denominator, while the number of persons who acquired the disease are in the numerator. Now, therefore, the incidence rate is equal to 2 cases divided by 35.5 person years, or 5.6 cases per 100 person years, or 56 cases per 1,000 person years. Okay, so let us now turn our attention to prevalence. What does prevalence have to do with epidemiology, as we generally talk about risks? Prevalence or point prevalence is the proportion of the number of cases of a disease at a specific time from the population of interest at that time. It ranges in value from 0 to 1 and removes the effect of total population size. It therefore makes estimates from different populations or over time more comparable. Here is an example of prevalence of echinococcosis in country Y in 1980. There are 96,200 cases in the year 1980 out of a population at that time of 350,000. Now, prevalence therefore is equal to 27.5%. As part of today's lecture on the different measures of disease occurrence, I am including this presentation to graphically show the relationship between incidence, prevalence, and disease duration. Imagine a container partially filled with an orange liquid, which represents prevalence. The height of the liquid is measured by the length of the blue arrow. The blue arrow, in turn, represents the duration. And the droplets of the orange liquid entering the container represent incidence. Now, some of the orange liquid coming out of this hole may represent deaths, cured persons, those persons, and others. In our study of measuring disease occurrence, we cannot ignore the disease ability to spread. with the current COVID-19 pandemic, knowing the number of people, that one infected person will pass on a virus to, on average, cannot be underemphasized. Measles has one of the highest numbers with an R number of 15 in populations without immunity. Now that means on average, one person will spread in others. In the case of COVID-19, it has a reproduction number of about 3 if we take no action to stop it from spreading, according to experts. So in the next few more slides, I'll attempt to show you and give you an overview of this reproduction number that is commonly called R. Now R technically is a mathematical term that enables one to know how contagious an infectious disease is. It is also referred to as the reproduction number. As an infection is transmitted to new people or new persons or individuals, it reproduces itself. R also tells you the average number of people who will contract a contagious disease from one person with that disease. It also applies to a population of people who were previously free of infection and have not been vaccinated. As an example, if a disease has an R of 18, a person who has the disease will transmit it to an average of 18 other individuals. Now that replication will continue if no one has been administered a vaccine against the disease or is already immune to it in that community or in their community. Okay, what do R values mean? There are three cases for the spread potential of a disease depending on the R value. If the value is less than 1, its existing infection causes less than 1 new infection. In this case, the spread of the disease will decline and eventually be gone. If the value is equal to 1, the infection causes 1 new infection. And this means that the disease will stay alive and stable, but there won't be an outbreak or an epidemic. If the value, however, is more than 1, the infection causes more than 1 new infection, and this means that the disease will be spread between people, and there is always the risk of having an outbreak or epidemic, to say the least. There are certain situations under which the R values can apply. It is important to note that the disease R value only applies under the assumption that everyone in the population is completely vulnerable to the disease. Now, this means that no one has been vaccinated, no one has had the disease before, and that there is no way to control the spread of the disease. This combination of conditions is rare nowadays, thanks to the advances in medicine. Many diseases that were deadly in the past can now be contained and sometimes cured. For example, in 1918, there was a worldwide outbreak of the swine flu that killed 50 million people. According to experts, the R value of the 1918 pandemic was estimated to be between 1.4 and 2.8. But when the swine flu or H1N1 virus came back in 2009, its R value was only between 1.4 and 1.6. The existence of vaccines and antiviral drugs made the 2009 outbreak much less deadly. So, what is the COVID-19 R value? According to experts, the R for COVID-19 is a median of 5.7. And this is according to a study published online in Emerging Infectious Diseases. You can check on this. And the 5.7 is about double an earlier R estimate of 2.2 to 2.7. Now, what does 5.7 mean? The 5.7 means that one person with COVID-19 can potentially transmit the coronavirus to 5 to 6 people rather than 2 to 3, as researchers have originally thought. Now, researchers calculated the new number based on data from the original outbreak in Wuhan, China. They use parameters like the virus incubation period, which is about 4.2 days, how much time elapsed from when people were exposed to the virus and when they started to show symptoms. The researchers also estimated a doubling time of 2 to 3 days, which is much faster than earlier estimates of 6 to 7 days. The doubling time is how long it takes for the number of coronavirus cases, hospitalizations, and deaths to double. The shorter the time, the faster the disease is spreading. Still, according to experts, with an R of 5.7, at least 82% of the population needs to be immune to COVID-19 to stop its transmission through vaccination and herd immunity. So, what are the factors being considered to calculate the R of a disease? Now, the following factors are accounted for to calculate the R. We have infectious period, we have contact rate, and finally, we have the mode of transmission. We will briefly discuss each one in the following slides. So, the first consideration is the period of infection. Now, it is worthwhile to note that some diseases are more contagious for longer periods than others. As an example, according to the CDC, adults with the flu are typically contagious for up to 8 days. And children can be contagious for longer than that. The longer the infectious period of a disease, the more likely a person who has it can transmit the disease to other people. So what all of this means is that a long period of infectiousness will contribute to a higher R value. So the next consideration is the contact rate. If a person who has a contagious disease comes into contact with many people who are not infected or vaccinated, the disease will naturally be transmitted more quickly. Now, if that person remains at home in a hospital or otherwise quarantined while they are contagious, the disease will be transmitted more slowly. So, a high contact rate will contribute also to a higher R value. So the last consideration is the mode of transmission. It is worthwhile to note that the diseases that are transmitted the fastest and easiest are the ones that can travel through the air, such as the flu or measles. Now, physical contact with a person who has such a disease is not needed to transmit it. You can contract the flu from breathing near someone who has the flu, even if you have never touched them. Now, as a way of contrast, diseases that are transmitted through bodily fluids such as Ebola or HIV are not as easy to contract or transmit. This is for the reason that you need to come into contact with infected blood, saliva, or other bodily fluids to contract them. And airborne illnesses tend to have a higher R value than those spread through direct contact. Here are my references for this topic, which is about measures of disease occurrence. I'd like to thank you for viewing this recorded lecture.